Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Oh Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Oh Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. Lord, our righteousness, Lord, our righteousness, Lord, our righteousness. You're the Lord, our righteousness, Lord, our righteousness, Lord. our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. The Lord our righteousness. Oh Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my. Oh Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my. Desire of all nations, Jesus, my. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my. Lord Jesus, desire of all nations, Jesus, my King. And I worship you, Lord. I will sing of my Savior, and I will sing of his love, and I will sing of redemption poured out on Calvary's cross. Yes, I will sing of my Savior, and I will sing of his love, and I will sing of redemption poured out on Calvary's cross. I will sing of my Savior, and I will sing of his love, and I will sing of redemption poured out on Calvary's cross. I will sing of my Savior, and I will sing of his love, and I will sing of redemption poured out on Calvary's cross. Know the power of his love, know the power of his blood, oh, the power of his love, know the power of his blood, oh, the power of his love, oh, the power. Savior's love. My Savior's love. My Savior's love. My Savior's love. My Savior's love. Saviors, voila, 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 you've given, voila, 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 yeah, Jesus. My Savior's love. Oh, my Savior's love. My Savior's love. Oh, Allah, oh, Allah. My Savior's love. Oh, my Savior's love. My Savior's love. Oh, I love. Oh, I love. Oh, I love you, King. Oh, I love. Oh, I love. Oh, I love you, King. Oh, I love. Oh, I love. Oh, I love you, King. Oh, I love. Oh, I love.
The healing strength.
dreams of heaven. The precious blood of Jesus, Christ Jesus. Thy healing streams of heaven, the flowing of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, the healing streams of heaven, the precious blood of Jesus Christ, Jesus. The glory of the Lord, the great grace and salvation, the healing streams of heaven, the precious blood of the Lamb, Christ Jesus. For the healing streams of heaven, the flowing of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, for the glory of the Lord, the glory of His Spirit, His great salvation, the great grace and salvation. Lord, praise, oh God, Lord, we praise you. We worship you, oh God, and we worship you, Lord, almighty God, we worship you. Flowing of God's Spirit, flowing of His precious, wonderful love. Hallelujah. God, blessed is your name, Almighty God. The precious blood of the Lamb, Christ Jesus, healing streams of heaven, the flowing of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, flowing to me now. Flowing through me now, flowing to us now, flowing through our lives. The healing streams of heaven, the precious blood of the Lamb, Christ Jesus. The healing streams of heaven, the flowing of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit, flowing through us now. stealing streams of heaven are flowing of the blood of Christ Jesus. Healing streams of heaven, the flowing of God's Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Your glorious salvation, your great grace, O God, poured out. God poured out the healing streams of heaven, the flowing of the blood of Christ Jesus, the healing streams of heaven. The Spirit, the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. There's none like you, O God. Your great salvation, Lord. I'll take heaven. I'll take Jesus. I'll take the life forevermore. I'll take His glory, His power, His presence any day than anything else that is offered. Hallelujah. If you would like to experience the presence of the living God, He's right here. You could be one person in the midst of 1,000 people that cannot experience the presence of God. And if your heart reaches to Him, you'll be the only one that's there, standing there in His glory. You could be, the one that stands in the midst of 1,000 people experiencing the presence of God. And the only difference is going to be made in your life is how your heart reaches to touch heaven, to know God, because He's made Himself available to anyone who hungers and thirsts, anyone who comes to Him with a true and sincere heart. Just about everybody believes they know God. I mean, I've spent so much of my life studying what everybody believes about God. And at the end of the day, it is one big gigantic mess. The reality of it is His Father came and revealed Himself in His only begotten Son, Jesus Christ. Father gave to us His Word, which many people have many different things to say about, but, left on its own, it does a very good and complete job. God the Father just waiting for somebody to believe about those things which He spoke to us through His only begotten Son, who is the Word. The revelation, the declaration, the proclamation, the description, everything that God Himself is. He purposed that should be fully manifested all of His power in the person. God who was made flesh. The world, much of the world, celebrates His birth. They say that a majority of the world even celebrates His death. But it seems few who can celebrate His life. And experience His manifest glory and receive the benefits of that which He rose from the dead and ascended up on high
to provide for us. The benefits of joy and peace and love, the benefits of divine health, the benefits of divine power and ability to do what pleases God, to live in days of heaven upon the earth right now. Few seem to have ever encountered the greater part of that which God has revealed in His Word. God did not create man in a desolate wilderness, created him in a beautiful and glorious garden of plenty. Man chose to walk into the realms of hell and darkness, into the desolation of a wilderness life. Through Christ Jesus, the door has been open. You can step through today. You can step through right now. Oh yeah, you have to run through the barriers of religion and ideology and philosophy and choices that have nothing to do with God and cultural demands. You got to run through all that, yes. And yeah, there are a lot of high walls too. But there's a pathway right through it all. It's a narrow one. You got to squeeze through. And only few that find it. Only few that find the pathway to squeeze through. I love being in the woods. And I love taking people out into the woods who lived in the city all their life. And I like to sit back and watch them meander around as they try to be the trailblazer. They don't know which way's up. You know, it's always funny just kind of let them lead just a little bit. And then all of a sudden they come to their senses and say, "Where are we at?" There is a path that the trained eye can see. There's a path. It's a trail. It's like a highway. But unless you've lived in the woods, you don't see it as a highway. It looks like a deer track or a deer trail, if you even know what that is. Father's shining abundant light upon this narrow path you got to squeeze through. Jesus said, "The narrow is the way that leads unto life, and few there be that find it." Even though He's lit it up with the effulgency of divine power and glory, few there be that find it. Why? Because man, in his arrogance and his boasting and the pride of his own heart, refuses to humble himself to hear the voice of God. Refuses to humble himself to be instructed and be led. And Satan creates a deception and an illusion that you're safe, that you know where you're at, that you know what you're doing. That is funny. That is funny. And I pray today that the reality of where you're at and what you're doing and where you're going and the frailty of your breath that comes in and out of your nostrils, in and out of your mouth, would somehow be something that you're more aware of, more sensitive to. You begin to understand that you don't understand where you pass from this life into the next. You do not know the way thereof. You do not know the path thereof. God in His loving kindness opened up the door, and Jesus, "I'm the way thereof. I'm the path. I am the door. I am the life. I am the truth." God's just waiting for men to believe, because men are all encumbered by all these things, all these ideas. But Jesus stands knocking at the door of your heart. He's the only one. He's the only one. Knocking at the door of your heart, saying, "Just let me in. I can't even imagine such love. I cannot even imagine such love. That God so loves us that He comes pleading, begging, as it were, banging on the door. Please let me in. Please, please, if any man will hear my voice and open up the door, I will come in and bring the fellowship. I come in, I bring in the relationship. I come in, I bring in the life. I come in, I bring in the glory." People have been living their life in a septic system, believing they're swimming in crystal pure water. Oh, that the lights would be turned on. People are delighting in sin and iniquity, the worst forms of death and corruption that could be imagined. God wants to bring us into an abundant life of his righteousness and his heavenly realms of divine glory and goodness. People live in chaos and hate and anger and lust. Only Christ Jesus can set you free from that. People, I've been with Muslims all over the world. They not free from that. I've been with Buddhists all over the world. They not free from that. I've been with Hindus all over the world. They not free from these things. I've been with Christians all over the world, and they not free from these things. But God has made a way through Christ Jesus so you and I can live out at days of heaven upon the earth and live a heavenly life walking in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. And he stands banging on the door of your heart, saying, let me show you how, let me teach you how. Just open up, I'll come in. And I'll fellowship with you. You know, a lot of people got a lot of ideas about grace and about the Lord Jesus, but if they would just read those things that Jesus has to say about his expectations of the church in Revelation chapter 2 and Revelation chapter 3, which I am referring to as I'm quoting this verse of scripture, saying, Jesus saying, behold, look here, see me. I'm standing at the door of your heart and I'm knocking. They just begin to ponder those things that he says there to the churches. Suddenly their disposition about what God feels and what he expects would be radically changed in most instances, in most cases. Because he's the one who stands in the midst of his church, that he's sanctified and washed with the water of his word, that he's cleansed with his blood, that he's baptized in the Holy Ghost and fire. And his eyes are like a flame of fire, and his hair is white like wool. And he has his kingly and his priestly garments on, and he's like one that outshines the sun in a blazing glory that looks like he's on fire in the fire. And he says, I have somewhat against you because your way is not perfect. You repent quickly or I will come and fight against you with the sword of my mouth. He lays it out there in that last little phrase there in Revelation chapter 3, speaking to the church at Laodicea, saying you're blind and you're miserable, you're wretched and you're naked. You think that you can see. You think that you're rich. You think that you're clothed, but you're not. You're blind, you're wretched, you're poor, you're miserable, you're naked. I counsel you to buy of me gold tried in the fire. That's what he says, that you may have white raiment. And he says in that context, with their state of being, with their arrogance, thinking that they know God when they are just so far from him, you know, being a false representation of what it means to be redeemed and purchased with the blood of Jesus and filled with the Holy Ghost. And, you know, though he could have had a lot of responses to that situation and that abuse and that offense and that injury against relationship that he provided through his own blood, yet still he says, I stand at the door of your heart knocking. I'm pleading with you, begging you, open up the door and let me come in and take full control of your life. Let me show you how to live life, because all you know how to do is live death. Let me show you how to live love, because all you know is how to live hate. Let me show you how to live in peace, because all you know how to do is live in condemnation and strain and shame. He's an amazing God. He's going to fight with you to the day that you breathe out your last breath. He's going to wrestle with you, rather, to try to bring you to this place. Many men and women have perished and died in their sins because they have rejected and refused time and time again this love, this grace, this mercy, saying, no, I don't believe it. No, I'm going to do it my own way. To open up their eyes, to lift up their eyes in a place called torment, because they chose death rather than life. They chose cursings rather than blessings. They chose the way of transgression rather than the way of redemption. God stands pleading with you today. Christ Jesus, the living God, the eternal Word made flesh, for one purpose, to die on Calvary's cross. He stands pleading with you today, begging you, stop it. Stop living that way. Stop living in your hate. Stop living in your lust. Stop living in a realm of fellowship with demon spirits, because that's all that is. That's why John said, he that sins is of the devil. What a radical declaration in 1 John chapter 3 and verse 8. He that does righteousness is of God. Making a very clear distinction for all of us to see, no matter what your philosophy or ideologies are and your beliefs and your opinions, God's word is unchanging. God's word is forever settled in heaven. God's word came and testified as the living word of every word of the written word, pleading with us to come on in to the realms of his goodness and come on into the realms of his life. He's opened up the door. Men sat in darkness. Men sat under the shadow of death. And the light sprang up. And you would have thought that all men would have come to the light. Even bugs got enough sense to go to the light. You would have thought that all men would have come to the light. But they did not. Because when it comes down to the end analysis, men love darkness rather than light. Because they love iniquity, they love sin, they love evil, they love their lust. It isn't nothing to do about what they believe. That's all just a sham. All that is just a cover up. They don't believe it, and anybody who believes what they're saying, well, they're just as deceived. Men don't come to Christ Jesus, and they don't come to walk with God, because they love the wages of unrighteousness. But God's just looking for somebody, anyone. Still, he does not give up. Still, he does not faint. Still, he does not weary. Still, he leaves the 99 religious and goes searching for the one. Goes searching for the one. Is there a one in this place today that you've never called upon the name of Jesus, or you've never really understood what it means to walk with God? You just thought, well, you know, this is just another religion and it sounds good, and you know, all I got to do is a couple of few things, and then, you know, I've got all my eternity all figured out and fixed up, and I can continue living my life the way I've been living it. No, Jesus died to set you free from the life you've been living. He set you free from the realms of the tyranny. You know, in the beginnings of the United States of America, there were those who said, give me liberty or give me death. Well, you know what? I've never seen that as a cry for really a nation. I've seen that as a cry for a spiritual disposition. Ha! Ha! Tabaranea. Sibrongadea. Prasita. Where people will become so earnest about living in this so great a salvation and walk in this freedom that Christ Jesus declared when he said, he that the Son sets free is truly and sincerely and indeed free. He that the Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, gives liberty to, they have real liberty. They are no longer under the tyranny of the dictates of the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life and every foul spirit that with its deceptive work creates within man's consciousness and psyche that they desire iniquity when men desire none of it, really. Not in the depths of their heart. They live under a deception. They've given themselves over. They've bent their will to the demonic. Jesus stands at the door of your heart and he's knocking and he wants to set you free. He wants to liberate you from a desire of iniquity and sin. You know, when you think about it, you know, everyone should hate murder. Murder is a terrible violation against another human being. But everyone should equally hate sexual immorality, because it is also a terrible violation against another human being. We live in a culture and society that actually gets excited about watching a demon spirit literally destroy another human being, and they like to watch that. And that's how they get their pleasure. It's, as far as I'm concerned, worse than the watching the gladiators go at it, or watching the elephants stomp Christian babies like grapes. And I'm going to talk about other wretched things that men have done in the history of the human race. I'm so glad that Jesus Christ came to set me free from the history of the human race. I'm so glad that God came set me free from the human condition. Hallelujah. I've been set free from the human condition, been brought into the family of God. I find myself in a divine situation, having been made the temple of the Almighty God. The Holy Ghost lives here. The blood of Jesus Christ has cleansed me, brought me near. There's no more shame nor offense, nothing that holds me back from this entry in. There's nothing that holds me back, because all the offense is removed. I am complete in Him. Totally accepted in the Beloved. Don't have to stand before Him wondering what I must do to be liked by Him, loved by Him, to be able to draw near Him. For I've come near as you can come by the blood of the Lamb, through this new creation, by the wonderful working of the Holy Ghost. I have access by His Spirit. Hallelujah. Why would men turn this down? Why would men turn away? Why would men choose hell? People say, oh, a loving God would never have a hell or send anyone to hell. Are you kidding me? Listen to me. Why would we blame it on God again? Always blaming it on God. People choose hell every day. Every day they make choices of death and destruction, of hate and offense, of unforgiveness, of some kind of strife and envy and rebellion. Every day. Men choose hell. It's a choice that men make. They are destroyed by their own wickedness, consumed by their own iniquity. The only thing we can blame God for is loving us so much He died for us. Loving us so much He won't give up, and He won't allow anything to get in the way of you and I making a right choice. It's all you can blame God for. All you can blame God for is wanting to deliver you from hell and bring you into heaven today, so you can start making heavenly choices to live in heaven, to say yes to those things that He has spoken, because every word was designed so that you and I can live in life with Him, in heaven with Him right now, today, in His love and His joy and His peace and His goodness. He's calling you, He's beckoning you, He's pleading with you. God the Holy Ghost is talking to you. It's time for you to change. And God made the way of change, because if man was left to change on his own, he'd be that much more hopeless. That much more hopeless. I'm amazed at how men will go and talk to other men about these wonderful heavenly things, and all they can do is come up with something that comes out their head, when God the Holy Ghost is rather there to explore the depths of man's choices and desires and need. Through your mouth, through your very expression, He wants to fill you with all of His glory. Won't you just let Him? Won't you just let Him? I want you to say yes to God. Say, okay, Lord, I want to walk with You. I want to know You. I want to be Yours. I want to make it up as I go. Shoot from the hip. Father wants to make you a success. Hallelujah. A success. Some people think being a success is having a bunch of money in the bank. That's not a success. That could be the epitome of a failure. Some people think success is measured by the clothes you wear, the house you live in, the car you drive, the people that you're around. That could only be another, once again, a description of failure. That is a success that a culture, a twisted culture, imposes upon us. Oh, success is knowing God. Success is knowing Him and walking with Him, and every day learning how to be empowered by the Holy Ghost to do it His way, to say yes to Him, to say no to sin. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah. He's not far from you. He's not far away. You know how close he is? A broken heart. He enters through the life of men with a brokenness, a broken heart. To say, God, I'm sorry for my sin. I'm sorry for the way that I've lived. I've lived my life as an offense unto you. And I want to change. I want to be holy and I want to be acceptable to you. I want to step into that which you provided for me to be able to step out of all but sin and iniquity is imposed on me. A broken and a contrite heart, something that is real, genuine. A person says, I really want change. I'm done. Jesus did not die so that men could continue in their way of sin and iniquity. He died at Calvary's cross for everyone who wants liberty, who wants to come into a new nation. I belong to a royal priesthood and a holy nation. Hallelujah. United States of America is an afterthought to my ancestors. They came here in 1625 with the purpose of having a freedom to be able to move with God, move in God, and seek God without restraint by the state church of England and of the various different places of Europe, Germany. They came here, have Pentecostal fire fall, and then see God take them as a light to the nations. And evil men will come in. They the ones who opened up the door. They the ones who opened up the pathways and the highways. Evil men came in and flooded in behind it. It's true. Somebody said, well, that's not what I learned in school. Well, I didn't learn mine in school. I learned mine from Dad and Grandpa and Great-Grandpa. Hallelujah. School's going to have to line up with reality. Are you listening to me? Kasuta anamike kalimasapatiyo. Hallelujah. Mandoro sivridesti. Hallelujah. And you know, a big part of their drink and true. I was just with the emperor of the Congo. The emperor, the king of kings of the Congo. And with the kings of Zambia who are descendants from the king of Congo. Most of the unfortunate reality of what happened with slavery, most of those people that were so terribly abused came out of the Congo and Zambia. And here he is, a man full of a love for God and a desire for the things of the Spirit, wanting his whole nation of the Congo to come under the mantle of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Wanting the rivers and the streams of heaven to flow through the mountains and the valleys of the Congo. That's a product of what our ancestors wanted. They had nothing to do with this mess. They didn't envision this mess that goes on in our great cities from Chicago to New York. They envisioned that mess. They envisioned the mess of what we got going on in Congress and the Senate and a Hillary and a Trump. They didn't envision that mess. They didn't envision the oppression that is put on men through the agencies. The commissions that are designed to oppress the people of America. Oh God, revive us again. 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 Revive our nation again, oh God. It will happen. It will happen. Because there's people that will seek God. Today we enjoy one of the great breakthroughs in the Holy Ghost because of a one-eyed black man named Pop Seymour. Many of us call him Dad. Because he took a hold, even in the midst of a great oppression and a great affliction and great persecution and great segregation, it didn't bother him. He sought a kingdom whose builder or maker was God. He wasn't looking at what men were doing anyways. He didn't receive from man what was he was after. Just up the road a little ways in Azusa Street, If you go into my office, when you walk into my office, one of the first things you're going to see is a picture of Pop Seymour. I had a couple year black couple here the other day, and they loved the Lord, loved the heart, and they went into my office and they said, "Who's that black man up there on your wall?" I said, "Well, that's Pop Seymour." They said, "Who's that?" And these are people, Pentecostals. And I'm like, "What? You don't know that God used a one-eyed black man to touch heaven to bring a Pentecostal movement in 1906 on April the 9th that changed and rocked the nations of the earth? Come on. You got to be kidding me. What you been listening to? Who you been getting your information from? You got to quit watching CNN and Fox News and all the rest of that garbage. You need to get yourself in heaven. Find out what's going on in the midst of the church. Find out what's going on in the midst of the things of the Spirit of the living God. Give me a break. Hello. All the wonderful things that belong to the Spirit of the Lord and the glory of His love and His diversity. People all fixated on what is the recent headlines that come right out of the pit of hell. Jesus. Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. He stands at the door of your heart knocking. He stands right now at the door of your heart knocking. What will you do with Jesus? On that day, when Pilate stood before Israel, he presented to them a man, a zealot, who could lead Israel in a rebellion against the Roman Empire with sword. Well, really, all they had really was slings and stones to put in them. That was about it. Or they could have Jesus, the King of Heaven. They could either have an earthly leader, or they could have a heavenly leader. And they cried out when Pilate said, "What would you have?" They said, "Give us Barabbas. We'll take an earthly leader. We'll take someone who we can get behind with the arm of flesh and human ability, something that we can feel like we got control over." What should I do with Jesus? Well, he means nothing to us. Do what you will. And there was only one choice. You could be seated. Do what you will. There was only one choice. The one choice was crucify him. Put him to death. What will you do with Jesus? Listen, what will you do with Jesus? What will you do with Jesus? Thank you, Father. You know, I love looking around. I see so many different nations in here right now. I love looking around and seeing that. I mean, we love the nations. I love the nations. I love running to the nations. Colombia, India's here. Mexico's here. Huh? United Nations is here. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Father has brought together Ethiopia's here. I love Ethiopia. I love all of Africa. I love Africa probably more than I love Europe. Just spend some time in Africa, you'll understand what I'm saying. Amazing. Some of the most amazing people on the planet in Africa. Just love the nations. It won't be long to see more people from Kashmir. We see Kashmir set free. I'm going to see Kashmir set free. I'm going to see the tyranny that's been held over Kashmir for 3,000 years broken. In Jesus' name. It should have been happening a long time before I was born. But I figure I'm not dying until it's done. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm going to send Ruthie Anna and Cade and Daniel and Summer to Kashmir for a while after baby comes. Gets a little. Cuba's, we just got a report from Cuba. Where's Sandy? I thought I saw Sandy come in. Sandy's upstairs helping. Just had a report from Cuba. They're continuing to work on my meeting with Fidel Castro and with Raul. Hallelujah. Raul's like said, they say that Raul is the richest man in the world. He doesn't like people to say that because bottom line of it is a dictator. He owns all Cuba kind of thing, you know. So that's what makes, but he doesn't own it. He doesn't own it. But I figure, well, if we can get Raul changed, transformed, baptized in the Holy Ghost, things are going to be good.
Hallelujah.
Everybody, first thing, so I said, well, that'd be a lot of finance for the kingdom. No, first thing is everybody gets their stuff back. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
We got a wonderful, you know, plan and vision that the Lord's given us and for Cuba, and he's made it. The Lord doesn't, we think that somebody's got to be, you know, some grandiose superstar, you know, wealthy person, you know, to be able to do anything. That's not the way the Lord does it. Papa picks lowly folks that can't do nothing on their own, like me. People that just are just losers on their own, huh? People that be doing nothing but out in the woods, you know, following some cows around. Somebody like me, huh? Come on. He does. He takes people from lowly places to go lay hands on Fidel Castro, because I want Fidel in heaven. Jesus wants Fidel in heaven.
Amen.
Now we basically were able to stir up the Church of Cuba so where that they wanted him in heaven, because when I got there, they wanted him in hell. They've been oppressed since 1959. Come on. They lived under a regime that really just was harmful to them in many ways. It's like one of the stories I like to tell is one of my friends in Cuba. He's a medical doctor. He's in his 60s. He's the guy who's in Havana, who's the physician who makes sure that all the other physicians are doing things properly. And he's not only a medical doctor and physician, his wife is a medical doctor and a physician. They both have been medical doctors all of their life, and they're both pastors. They've been bivocational medical doctors, pastors since they were in pre-med. Isn't that really cool? They could have left Cuba. But because of their education, they could have left Cuba. Because they had their connection, they could have left Cuba. They stayed. Because they said, we can't abandon the people. Who's going to take care of them? Come on, man. That sounds just like Jesus, doesn't it? Who's going to take care of them? And they get their allotment, 6 eggs, and $20 a month. 6 eggs. $20 a month, quarter pound of flour. Pretty crazy, isn't it? I'm almost to tell you guys. Holy Ghost power to set you free here. Right now. At this very moment. But you can do it your own way if you want to do it. And the only way that you're going to ever make a transition is where you get tired of you. You get tired of your choices and get tired of your way. And when you do, God will see that. And God, Father will see it. All heaven responds to that. A brokenness will come into your heart. And when that brokenness comes into your heart, you begin to cry out to God. I believe Fidel Castro is there right now. There are people mad at me. You know what I mean? People mad at me. Because I'm so, it's like, I'm like going, I went to a place the other day. I said, I'm just so thankful for President Obama. And they're looking at me, man. I'm telling you, if they were stones, they would have taken him up. Why? Because his policies, though they be in many ways anti-God, liberal policies, opened the door to Cuba, opened the door to Kashmir, all of a sudden opened the door to nations where nations weren't so afraid that we're going to come in and kill everybody. Huh? Are you listening to me? Ha ha! God can use whoever he wants to use. It doesn't have to meet our approval. God can do whatever he wants to do, however he wants to do it. I've got people, close friends of mine, they don't want anything to do with me anymore because of the things like that. Somebody says, can't you just keep it yourself? No. 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 I want the nations to be opened up. Somebody said, oh, we can't have all these Syrian refugees. I'm like, bring them. Mark, do you have to just be contrary on everything? No, because I'm going to go where they're at. If they're not here, I'm going to still go where they're at. Might as well bring them here and have them, you know, come on. Let everybody get involved. Woo! So I said, oh, they're going to kill us. You need to get saved and get protected by heavenly grace and divine power. I heard the other day, there's churches got snipers on their roofs. You got to be kidding me, man. What are you so afraid of? Holding on to your own life. Propaganda lies. People telling to create upheaval. Turn every man against his neighbor. Lies. Oh, Lord, revive us again. Oh, Lord, let revival sweep this land once again. And I believe with all my heart that that's what Father is setting up to do. But he's not going to be able to do it unless there's some people to cooperate with them and do it with them. Because he's not going to rend the heavens and come down. He already did that. Right. He rend the heavens, he came down, and he left. And he poured out the Holy Ghost and sent the Holy Spirit. And he's here to empower you and I to do what he died and rose again and ascended in heaven. Hallelujah. To be able to produce within us his life in his ministry. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. But you're going to have to love liberty instead of loving bondage. You're going to have to love freedom instead of loving imprisonment and captivity. And that liberty and that freedom is that which is brought through the new birth when we are born again. When we made a new creation. Where his glory and his power and his life now lives in us, where we are his family, moved from the human race into a divine race. It's true. When God called Abraham out that day, a new race was born. We call them Ivrit, or Hebrews, or Jews now, because of the Babylonian exile. When Jesus Christ opened up the door for us to be born again, to be born of the Word, to be born of the Spirit, to be begotten of God, a new race was born. Hallelujah. And it has nothing to do with the hue of your skin, the color of your skin. Nothing to do with the nation that you came from or the language that you speak. Somebody said, well, ask me. They say, well, you know, what nation are you from? Well, I'm United Nations. I'm Heinz 57 sauce. I got some of everybody. Yeah. Hallelujah. And that's what the Lord did. He took up all nations and made them one new man. Hallelujah. Let's look just like Jesus. Ha, 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 ha. I'm just a product of what God did, as it were. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It is an amazing thing to think that we've been made the family of God through the new birth and Father shutting no man out. I truly believe that when I stand in front of Fidel Castro, because I feel something that he was reaching for truth, but he was reaching in realms, of course, of deception. I believe that God's going to touch his soul. I believe that he's going to be born again. I believe that these things are going to happen in the nation of Kashmir. These things are going to happen in Kabul, Afghanistan. I believe it. We had did you know that Kabul, that Afghanistan used to be almost like we're a modern nation? Did you know that? Iran? You know, 60 years ago. Are you listening to me? It was. This is the way it was. It was modernized. It was just in the 60s and 70s, it was on track with the rest of the world. The church failed miserably. Government stepped in and started oppressing and afflicting and doing all these crazy things because the church wasn't doing what the church is called to do. You know, praise God, he raised up zealots. Amen. I'm a zealot in the kingdom of God. I want you to be a zealot too. The Lord said, be zealous. Amen. Be a zealot for spiritual gifts. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. He's called us to go and have a love for people, a love for the lost in a dying world. A love for souls. You know, I could just as easily go right now. I saw on Facebook some people I was just with, and they were with the Emperor of the Congo and his wife, whom my wife and I were just with. And they were all standing there in a line and together. So honored to be around the Emperor and the Empress. And they said, this is Team Congo. And I'm like jealous. I could go live the rest of my life in the Congo. It was a thought that seemed so far out of reach 20 years ago. And you know, the Lord didn't, I know I'm going to get to do some things in the Congo because the Lord didn't have me prophesying to the king of the Congo, or the emperor of the Congo, for almost 5 days for for nothing. You know, just declaring, hey, this is the way it's got to happen. You know, when we were with them, they had just had new burst of civil war going on in the Congo because of elections and because of the way the political system is going on right now there. And he said, well, this isn't a good time. I said, no. This is the perfect time. God just seems to be able to move in and take over when everybody's sword is against their own brother. Well, they're all confused over there, rumbling around there. We'll just go prophesy and preach the gospel and watch the power of God fall upon a nation and peace come. Because when Jesus is there, peace is there. When the Holy Ghost flows, peace is there. The only reason that we don't have peace in our inner cities is because the power of God isn't there the way that, and being made manifest the way that God ordained. I say in Jesus' name, change comes.
Amen.
Change comes. What will you do? Will you live your own life? Will you just believe your own stuff? Do it your own way? Write your own Bible. Why don't you take Matthew and write it the way that you live it? Why don't you take 1 John and write it the way you live it? Why don't you edit Ephesians and write it the way you live it? Why don't you edit Romans and write it the way you live it? Or get honest with God, submit to Him, say, Lord, I know You know the way that life is supposed to work. I know that You know the way that is good and the way that is right. And I want in every way be conformed to Your image and do it Your way. You know, the Lord looks at Abraham in Genesis chapter 17, verse 1, Abraham being 99 years old. And God said to him, said, you walk before Me and you be perfect. Somebody thinks, well, what an obligation, what a burden. No, the word spoke out empowerment to the life of one who would believe. God speaks out empowerment. Words will either bring you into prison. They will bring you into bondage. They will bring you into strife. They will bring you into an imprisonment. Or they'll liberate you. They'll set you free. They'll empower you. They'll give you divine ability. Hallelujah. Many people are entangled by the word of men, by the word of doctors, by the word of political pundits and surrogates. Huh? They imprisoned by the words of lawyers and the words of bosses and government officials. God given to us His word that liberates, sets us free, empowers us, gives anyone who ever believes. It's a leveling floor. It has nothing to do with anything about your genealogy and anything that you've done with your life up to this point, your education or the lack thereof. It has to do only and solely with your response to the word of God, to believe that He knows how life is supposed to work, that He designed it, and He shows us now through His love and grace how to live it, how to walk it out. Though men were in prison because of the sin and the transgression of Adam, Christ Jesus came to break that yoke and liberate all men so that we could walk with Him. And that obedience that He had ultimately results to where that there can be many offenses and we still have an uninterrupted walk with God. If our heart's right with God, we want to know it and do it His way. Amen. We want to know how it works His way and do it His way. I want you to open your Bibles quickly with me. Just one last bit of exhortation to you. Hallelujah. Praise God. 1 John chapter 5. Let me just, you know, this is the way I do it. I just kind of move like this. We're going to do School of the Spirit this week. Amen. Friday, School of the Spirit, 7 o'clock. We'll be here Wednesday night. We'll do Wednesday night meeting. And we're just so earnest to see God's people begin to seek Him and lay hold on heaven. People, if you're never empowered to do anything more than just know God and love Him and worship Him with your whole heart, you've now stepped into a place to begin to shine as a light in a dark place. But I'm going to tell you this. If you do that, you're going to do a whole lot more. There's all these people who are success-driven. They're overachievers and all the rest of the achievers. Underachievers, overachievers, doesn't matter. The reality of it is will you know Him? Will you love Him? Will you stop having false expectations and stop wanting to be somebody and let Him be the one who lives? Huh? Because if you will, I'm telling you, you'll step into great things in God. And it just all begins with the way that you're going to love him and have a relationship with him. The proof that he's moved in and you have fellowship with him. Huh? And he's not sitting there saying, I don't like the house I'm living in. I can't believe the way you decorated the living room. I'm not going in that kitchen. It smells. He cleaned the place up. He likes the house. Hallelujah. He's pleased to dwell with us. Hallelujah. Praise God. He empowers us to be holy as he is holy, to be righteous as he is righteous, to be perfect even as our Father in heaven is perfect, to teach us, to train us, to lead us, to guide us, to show us the way that we need to walk in. He's there with his love and his mercy to forgive us over and over again so long as our heart is set on doing it right and getting it right and being right. Hallelujah. Good news, eh? Good news. Tonight I'm a minister on faith. Moving in faith, the need of it, the power of it, and the things that come out against it to stop it and shut it down. What your response has got to be if you want to see the great things of God manifest in your life. Because somebody might have told you that we came to the playground, but I'm here to inform you. No, we in a battle. The fleshly lust war against our soul. That we have to be equipped by God to be strong in the strength of the Lord and the power of His might. Because we're not wrestling against flesh and blood. We don't need snipers on the top of our building. I go right to the source. I mean, I tell you, I go right to the source of violence. Somebody said, how can you go to these places in the nations and not be concerned? First of all, Father's in control. Second of all, I have authority over the one who rules them. Yeah, I got authority over that violent spirit that controls them. Hallelujah. I've proven it. I started proving it right. I began proving it in another dimension right here in downtown San Diego in the barrios, right in the middle of a bunch of gangs going at it, finding out that I had an authority to bring peace where there was violence, love where there was hate, joy where there's depression. Come on. It's wonderful to see this thing work right, you know. It's a terrible, frustrating thing to say, I don't know how it works. You know, to be in a vehicle completely out of control, you're screaming, I don't know how it works. I don't know where the gears are. Or to be sitting on something that has such ability and such power and such, you know, everything that you need to get a job done, and you don't even know how to turn the thing on. It's wonderful to know how love works. It's wonderful to know how joy works. So, you know, somebody said, oh, yeah, yeah. How would I know? Because you can access it anytime you want it. And that should be all the time. Who doesn't want to be happy all the time? I've never met a person who wants to be happy. Who doesn't want to live in goodness all the time? Who doesn't want to live in peace all the time? Who doesn't want to live in love all the time? Who doesn't want to live in these good things all the time? You would have to be insane not to want to be living it. Everybody wants this. Everybody wants it. They just don't know how to access it. They don't know how to live in it. But God has supplied a river. In many ways, it's just as much a part as the initial evidence is speaking in tongues. It's part of the initial evidence. Rivers. Oh, rivers of His love. Rivers of His joy. Rivers of His peace. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
And just one other thing, you know, I kind of integrate the announcements while I'm preaching. Because I can't, I just flow. You know, we got the church building on the ground in Oregon. Things getting ready to go up. We started drilling a well and hit a gusher. It was over 110 gallons a minute that they could measure, but it was actually bigger than that because it started causing the walls of the well to implode on itself. So it's probably, I don't know, who could be 10 times bigger than that? Could be 1,000. The well's good, it just broke. It sounds like a lot of Christians. No problem. We're going to reinforce that thing. Hallelujah. Get the right liner in there. Praise God so we can get that water flowing out on the surface. Right now, I don't care how much water you got on the inside. If you tell it's coming out, it ain't doing nobody any good. As long as it's underground, it just isn't doing you. It's going to thirst to death. And everybody else, it's going to be a parched land. In Jesus' name, the well fixer is here today. Hallelujah. The well digger's here today. Praise God. It's so wonderful to just think about it, that you could step into success right now. If you define success properly. Because I've known people with great wealth. Great wealth. They more sad than you are. great wealth, great riches, great power. They're more lost and can sleep less than you can sleep at night. They on the one end of the spectrum got everything, totally unhappy. You on the other end of the spectrum got nothing, totally unhappy. Wonder what's the solution for both parties, for both groups of people? Jesus. The way, Jesus, he is, he means the way into the life of God. That's what his name means. That's what his life means. That's what his goodness means, his love means, an empowerment that he's given right now. It works. It's real. I can't help it that religion interfered and stopped you somewhere short of being introduced to him. Today an introduction is promised. You've got to get a right heart to get the right thing. You got to want him more than your other stuff. Thank you, Jesus. First, did I say 1 John 5? Are you there, 1 John 5? Hang on, I'll get there in a minute. 1 John chapter 5. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We just love you, Lord. We thank you, Almighty God. Father loves you so much. Did you know that you loved? I don't care how big of a rascal you are, you loved. It doesn't matter how ornery you are, you're loved. God loved Gaddafi so much. I just should have been able to get to him. God loved Saddam Hussein so much. He was opening up Iraq to the gospel till we invaded. It's true. Somebody said, how do you know that? Because he was going to let us do a crusade there that October of that same year. It's true. All the stuff you're hearing on the news and all this time is propaganda. It's lies. It's lies. Get in tune with the Holy Ghost. Let him tell you what's really going on. First thing you're going to start doing is loving everybody people trying to tell you to hate. True. Jesus, help us. Jesus, help us. 1 John chapter 5, verse 1, whosoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. Hallelujah. And you have to understand that, is that simple? Does that sound pretty simple?
Yes.
You have to understand, though, that this is in light of John starting in the very first part of his epistle, defining who are born of God and who are not born of God. He says those who sin are not born of God. Those who walk in righteousness are born of God. Those who say they know God and do not keep his commandments are liars. This is all on the basis of everything that he said. So he's built up to a point now to where that this is a... defining believing, really. He's defining believing on the basis of not some kind of mental affirmation that you recognize that this is probably the case or there's more evidence in favor than against. Are you listening to me? Yeah. You did your pros and cons analysis, your five-star analysis, and you come to a conclusion that it must be. No, he's not talking about that kind of belief. He's talking about, he's defined belief as a life now, a life, a witness, a way that you conduct yourself, because he's defined it. He's made it very, very clear from the very beginning, and he used it on, his argument was on the highest level of authority. He said, we have heard him, we have seen him, we've looked upon him, and our hands have handled the word of life. The life was manifested, and we bear witness and show unto you that eternal life which was with the Father and was manifested unto us. See, that's how he starts the epistle. He comes on the highest level of authority. He was there. He was there. He stood in the midst of everything that Jesus did and was eyewitness of everything that he did and everything that he said. And he said, here's what it looks like. If you say that you know God and you walk in darkness, you are lying. You do not the truth. And then he picks it up in chapter 2 and he says, if you say that you know God and you do not keep his commandments, you are once again, you're a liar and you do not know the truth. And he goes through this over and over and over again. And he brings us now to helping us understand. He now brings in another word and he begins to now impose this word upon us in the context of all that he says. And now he makes us to realize that belief is more than an ideology, is more than a philosophy, is more than what people have defined by faith or just call faith. But it literally is a change of life. It is it is everything that we need and everything that God has supplied for us to be holy and acceptable unto him. And it's all found in knowing and confessing that Jesus Christ, that Jesus is the Christ, that he's the Messiah. And when you believe that, and when all of a sudden he can appear right now, and he's that real and he's that alive and he's everything that he said that he was, and he'll do everything that he said he would do, and that you'll be the product that he produced and purposed to bring forth, that he describes in John chapter 15 when he said, my Father is the husbandman, I'm the vine and you're the branch, and what kind of life you're going to live is the life that I've shown you. You listening to me? On that level, this is the belief, this is the faith, this is the change, as he said to Nicodemus. The same one who wrote this first epistle wrote John, the Gospel of John. And Nicodemus said, Rabbi, we know that you're a teacher sent from God, for no man can do the miracles that you do unless God be with him. Jesus immediately said, you cannot understand, enter in, or know the realms of the kingdom of God until you're born again. You must be born again. And it's in this context. Everyone, he says this, whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. We've got a context now for what belief is. When you read John chapter 3, 1 John chapter 3, if you don't understand it, I'll just go back and hit you with this one really quickly. Because this is the context of what belief is. In 1 John 3, 7, little children, let no man deceive you. He that does righteousness is righteous, even as God is righteous. He that commits sin is of the devil. The devil sins from the beginning. And for this purpose, the Son of God was manifested to destroy the works of the devil. Whosoever is born of God does not sin, does not practice sin, does not continue on sinning. For his seed remains in him because he's been born of God. He's a, hallelujah, the genetics of God, as it were, because that's the words that are used here. And he cannot sin because he's born of God. In this the children of God are made manifest, and the children of the devil. Whoever does not do righteousness is not of God. Neither he that loveth not his brother, they're not of God. Now he brings all of that, you know, built up once again. So many things I could say here, but I'd have to have you for another hour, and some of you look like you need to go take a shower. Or something. You look like you need to be in another place. I want to get you in this place because this is more important than any food you're going to eat, any shower you're going to take, any rest you're going to have. This gets you all the way to glory. Hallelujah. And have a good life at it too. Amen. Hallelujah. Whoever believes that Jesus is the Christ is born of God. I could say this. John says, I've laid out the proofs to you of who's born of God and who's not. And I want to show you that this all comes down to a concept of belief. To believe upon the only begotten Son of God. As many as received him, he gave the authority to be sons of God. As many as would believe upon his name, to believe who he is. To really believe who he is and want those things that he supplies means that your life has turned over to him. You no longer live. It's Christ Jesus that lives. This is the radical message. Everyone that loves God, here it goes, forgive me. And everyone that loves him that beget, listen to this. Everyone who, and I could put it to you another way. Everyone who loves the Father, that's the one who does the begotten. The begetting. I beget Elizabeth. I beget, hallelujah, Ruthie Anna, praise God, amen. I beget Joshua, hallelujah. Everyone who loves the one who begets, so in other words, he's saying in a very unique way to bring it right down to how intimate this is, how real this is, how we are literally the issue of God, how he now connects believing to literally being born again, to becoming a new race, to becoming the very issue of Almighty God, joint heirs with Christ Jesus, the brothers to the living God, Christ Jesus, who was made flesh, who rose up from the dead with a human earthly body, whose tabernacle, though he was eternally God and incarnated of flesh, with an earthly body died, and with an earthly body rose to immortality, and with an immortal earthly body, an immortal human frame, will live forever as the first fruits of the resurrection, with nail scars in his hand, and spear-pierced side, and nail scars in his feet, and a scarred brow, and a scarred back. One day he'll take his shirt off for me, so to speak. Are you listening? Yeah. To know him is to love him deeply. To love him deeply is to love all the human race, to love humanity. To go lay your life down for them that they may know this wonderful privilege, this wonderful grace that God has poured out upon all the human race, all humanity. Anyone who will believe. And maybe we can't have lost expectations. Maybe we'll find one in a thousand. One in a thousand. One in a thousand's worth it. Huh? One in a thousand's worth it. Because that's 1,000 and 10,000, you know. That's 1,000 and 100, what is that? One in 1,000 be 1,000 and 1,000,000, right? Or is it, am I getting my mouth right? Huh? That would be 1,000,000. That would be 1,000,000 in the midst of 100,000 or something like that. Am I getting it right? 1,000,000 and 1,000,000,000, rather. 1,000,000 people in a billion, folks. Is that right? 1,000,000 people in 1,000,000,000. That doesn't sound so good. Well, the Lord's willing to do it all for 1 in 1,000. 1 in 1,000,000,000. God's good. Yes.